Wormwood, yes. Amidst a dating relationship is the perfect time to sow those seeds which will grow up 10 years later into domestic hatred. The enchantment of unsatisfied desire leads to results which the humans can be made to mistake for the results of love. Avail yourself of the ambiguity in the word love. Let them think that they have solved by love problems which they have only waived or postponed under the influence of the enchantment. While it lasts, you have the opportunity to encourage these problems in secret and render them chronic. The grand problem is that of unselfishness. Note again the good work of our linguistic arm in substituting the negative, unselfishness, for the enemy's positive, loving-kindness. Thanks to this, you can teach someone from the very outset to surrender benefits, not so that others may be happy in having them, but so that they may be unselfish in foregoing them. That is a great point gained. Another great help, where the parties involved are male and female, is the divergence of view of unselfishness which we have built up between the sexes. A woman often means by unselfishness taking trouble for others. A man usually means not giving trouble to others. As a result, a woman who is quite far gone in the enemy's service will make a nuisance of herself on a larger scale than any man, except those whom our father has completely dominated. And, conversely, a man may be quite long in the enemy's service before he does as much spontaneous work to help others as a quite ordinary woman might do every day. Thus, while the woman thinks of doing good offices and the man of respecting people's rights, each sex, without any obvious unreason, can and does think of the other as radically selfish. On top of these misunderstandings, you can introduce a few more. The erotic enchantment produces a mutual complacence in which each is really pleased to give in to the wishes of the other. They also know that the enemy demands of them a degree of kindness which, if attained, would result in similar actions. You must make them establish as a law for their whole married life that kind of self-sacrifice which is currently sprouting naturally from the enchantment, but which, when the enchantment dies away, they will not have the kindness to sustain. They will not see the trap because they are under the double blindness of currently thinking that the sexual excitement is love and also thinking that the excitement will last. When once a sort of official, legal, or nominal unselfishness is established as a rule for the keeping of which their emotional resources have died away and their spiritual resources have not yet grown, the most delightful things result. When discussing any joint course of action, A must argue in favor of B's supposed wishes and against their own, and B must do the opposite. It is often impossible to find out either party's real wishes, and, with luck, they will end up doing something that neither wants, but each will have a sort of self-righteous glow and harbor a secret claim of preferential treatment in the future for the unselfishness shown, and a secret grudge against the other for how easy they accepted the sacrifice. Later on, you can venture on what may be called the generous conflict illusion. This game is best played with more than two players, in a family with grown-up children, for example. Something quite trivial, like having lunch in the yard, is proposed. One member makes it very clear, though not in so many words, that they would rather not, but of course are willing to do so because of unselfishness. The others instantly withdraw their proposal, ostensibly because of their unselfishness, but really because they don't want to be used as a sort of lay figure on which the first speaker practices petty altruisms. But the first is not going to be done out of their debauch of unselfishness so easily. They insist on doing what the others want. The others insist on doing what the first one wants. Passions are roused. Soon someone is saying, "Very well then, I won't have any lunch at all." And a real quarrel ensues, with bitter resentments on both sides. You see how it is done. Of course, if each side had been contending for its own real wishes, they would have all kept within the bounds of reason and courtesy. But just because the contention is reversed, and each side is fighting the other side's battle, all the bitterness which really flows from thwarted self-righteousness and the grudges of the last 10 years is concealed from them by the nominal unselfishness, or at least held to be excused by it. Each side is indeed quite alive to the cheap quality of the adversary's unselfishness, and to the false position into which the other is trying to force them. But each manages to feel itself blameless and ill-used, with no more dishonesty than comes natural to a human. A sensible human once said, "If people knew how much ill-feeling unselfishness occasioned, it would not be so often recommended from the pulpit." And again, she's the sort of person who lives for others. You can tell the others by their hunted expressions. All this and more can be begun even at the beginning of a dating relationship. A little real selfishness on your patient's part is often less valuable in the long run for securing his soul than the beginnings of this sort of self-conscious unselfishness that leads to the situations I have described. Some degree of mutual falseness, some surprise that the girl does not always notice just how unselfish he is being, can be smuggled in already. Cherish these things. But above all, do not let the young fools notice them. If they do notice them, they will be on the real road to discovering that love is not enough. That loving kindness is needed, and not yet present, and that no external law can take its place. I really wish that Slum Trumpet could do something about undermining that young woman's sense of the ridiculous.